Am I audible?
No, yes.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Sandeep from SV Multi Specialty Hospital. I hope I'm loud and clear.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. I'm going to talk about the hot topic for us. How are we going to manage our future practice here from now on, probably in the near future? All these things which I'm going to share for the next few minutes is of utmost importance. I thank IMA Kodambakkam for giving me this opportunity and hope I live to the expectations. So before jumping into the topic, let me see what all challenges actually we are facing here in this pandemic now. This is a novel coronavirus, a new disease with less than 6 months old duration. Probably not much we know about the disease. No vaccine, no cure. Our main burden is the asymptomatic carriers. We don't know who are having what. So we have to be very careful in this aspect. So this will create some fear among ourselves, from our staff members, everyone, because it has got a potential life risk and a possibility to spread to our family members by taking it home. The government does its part, but we are also morally responsible for the healthcare of this country. So definitely we need to do something about it. But one thing in our mind, which continuously is going on, is for how long? Frankly speaking, I too don't know the answer, but a safe guess would be for about a year, definitely. Each state has its own policy, and in each state, each district has its own policy, but at ground zero, ultimately the policy is getting delivered in a different way. What is a policy today may not be valid tomorrow. The more we know about the disease, the more we know about the virus, probably the things will change definitely. So we need to keep ourselves updated regarding this. So in my topic today now, we are going to discuss in different aspects. Mainly first, the changes what we need to make. How are we going to manage our human resources and staffing pattern? And what are the final financial implications we are going to deal with? Before doing anything, let us keep in mind that we are not heroes. We are not trying to be hero by doing something great. It is mainly first your own safety personally, take care of your health and your professional practice at last. So with this background, let us step into what all the changes we need to do. We have to consider a few things in general before we start our practice. Many of these things everybody will be know, and all patients should be considered to be asymptomatic carriers, first of all. Whether immaterial of their symptoms, immaterial of their complaints they are going to visit you, we need to consider them to have asymptomatic carriers of COVID-19 and follow social distancing norms. And before even starting our practice, probably few people are planning to start the practice from June 1st, that is tomorrow onwards. So even before that, we need to educate our staff members at every level, right from the housekeeping staff to the highest most level president or vice president of the hospital. So each person has their own role, has their own responsibilities, has their own way of handling the problem. So educating them is of utmost importance, providing them protective gear, mainly the N95 mask, the head shield, and the gloves. These three things are mandatory. The other things, providing the scrubs, PPE kits, head caps, all these things, depending on the place and the patients they deal with, it can be individualized. So we need to use minimally the fomites. That is, fomites means whatever the things we are going to use, mainly the mobile phones, because mobile phones is more kept on the table rather than keeping it inside. So usage of the speakerphone or a Bluetooth headset might be helpful. Encourage telemedicine. IMA is also changing its protocols here, policies here to encourage telemedicine so that the traffic inside your medical facility is as minimal as possible. Disinfect the mobile phones by just wiping it with some sterilium or any solution, any antiseptic solution at least, and avoid using mobile cases because mobile cases generally have rugged and rough surfaces which can trap these virus, and then probably cleaning is also not so easy. Practicing hygienic methods, avoid touching face and eyes is most important. Frequent cleaning of surfaces. We might be more interested in teaching the staff members how to clean the tables, the chairs, the walls, the handrails, all those things. But many things we forget is the computer, the telephones, the card swiping machine. All those things are of utmost importance, which are usually neglected and forgotten. So make sure even those things are being cleaned on a regular basis. Proper disposal of waste does not require any special mention here. I should say a disinfection procedure can be done in a three bucket system. That is, first with the plain water, clean that area, and then secondly with the detergent solution. And after that dries up, we can use 1% sodium hypochlorite solution to clean that area from the corner to the door and not stepping back into it. And door knobs, lift buttons, handrails, all the counters have to be cautiously and emphatically, we have to clean them. Chemoprophylaxis, as all know, hydroxychloroquine to the healthcare workers and their families if they are attending COVID positive patients. And now recently new interest has been started in the chemoprophylaxis involving vitamin C, B complex, zinc, indomethacin, ivermectin and all. So all these things are not yet proved to be 100% effective, but shows promising results. So it is better to take after considering the side effect profile of each of these drugs. So the staff, we are going to instruct them to use protective gear at all times. Staff consent, mainly to protect ourselves. I think this is has to be done without fail. We can take a consent from our staff saying the we know we are taking adequate precautions, but still the infection can attack them. So it is better to take this staff and keep this consent papers with us at all times to in order to legally protect ourselves. Many studies internationally, nationally have showed the healthcare professionals being infected by an inappropriate donning and doffing technique. So this technique has to be taught properly and followed at each level for all the healthcare workers. So what are all the changes, physical changes, what we need to do in our practice? So at the entrance, our changes in the practice starts at our hospital or clinic entrance itself. What are the changes? Minimize the entry and exit points, hand sanitizer, dustbin with lid, and we can display some general preventive measures of corona transmission and non-touch temperature screening. Probably all these things, not only hospitals, but every shop, every mall, or everywhere, they are going to start this one. And probably this thing is very important here. And we can even display what are all the measures we are going to we are taking in our hospital so that the patients and their attenders can follow us and help us in following all these practices. Allow only one patient at a time, and preferably only one attender, not more than that. Declaration forms to be signed by the patients and their attenders, and it is to be filed properly, separately, and kept with us. No matter whatever their symptoms are, we can get a declaration form. I am putting that form in the next slide. So no one should enter without a mask. This photograph is being taken in a corporate hospital where I work as a consultant. There they have appointed a person with a desk which has a sanitizer, a non-touch temperature screening, and a declaration form. as and when they enter the hospital itself, they are signing it, and then it is getting signed by the consultant whomsoever they are going to visit. And this photograph is our past president, Dr. Arunachalam's hospital, where I also work as a consultant. He has an innovative method where he does not allow much patients inside itself. He comes outside the hospital, sees the patient, examines them there itself, and then their staff members bring the medicines and all and deliver it outside the hospital so that the traffic inside the hospital is being reduced. After seeing that, I have considered and following that same practice in my hospital also, which is quite effective actually. So this is the declaration forms which we are getting it signed in our hospital here, this one. But, and it is being signed by whomsoever the doctor they are going to visit. And these are the policies. It can be individualized based on the center and the practice which we are they are having. So next place where the patient can visit is the waiting area, the reception. We should follow social distancing norms. Spacing of the appointments by not more than 6 patients an hour. Encourage telemedicine at this point of time. Display boards of hygienic practices. Distancing at the reception counters. This photograph is sent by my ophthalmologist friend from Karnataka. What he has done is he has put a bench in front of the reception counter so that they cannot, even if they want to, they cannot come forward to visit them. And from there, they are going to do everything. And this one is being followed at many places where alternating seating arrangement has been followed. So for ourselves personally, we have to use protective gear at all times, change to scrubs preferably, so that our clothes which we wear it to home is relatively clean. Lady doctors especially has to take care of their hair. If it is advisable to ask them to wear head masks, head caps, sorry. And loose ends of their dress, mainly like sari, pallu or dupatta, has to be taken care of, not touched frequently. Or better, change to scrubs. Keep eyes also covered, because recently I have come across a paper, and one of our IME members also have delivered a lecture how to protect the eyes and why to protect the eyes. So definitely protection of your eyes is very important, because the conjunctiva, which is moist, can easily entrap all the virus particles, and they can go through the nasolacrimal duct and go into the nasopharynx. So that is how this is the basic gist of how infection can be transmitted by unprotected eye. And specific changes with regard to their specialty. Each specialty has their own recommendations how to go about it, and that has to be followed definitely. So before going home, wash hands up to the elbow preferably. After going home, take bath, preferably head bath. No shoes. We Indians do not allow any footwear inside our house, but it has to be mentioned here. Nails to be trimmed properly. And if possible, avoid elders and children mingling with them, because it is shown to be very effective. And inside your consultation room, avoid AC as much as possible. The airflow, that is the air, the fan or the AC should be behind you going towards the patient. At least 2 meters distance should be maintained. Take a detailed history, in fact, little more than what we usually do, so that we can minimize the time of and contact of a clinical examination. Not more than 10 minutes each consultation. Wash hands after every consultation, even after touching their X-ray reports or the scan films which they bring. So it is very wise to clean our hands then. And we can ask the patient and attenders to go out and wait. So in meanwhile, you can write the prescription, and the prescription and the medicine's details can be explained by any one of your staff members, so that the exposure time for yourself inside your consultation room will be reduced. So in the casualty, on receiving a patient, give him a mask immediately. Take very brief and easy clinical examination. And main thing to remember, never be in a hurry. Whatever be the emergency, don't be in a hurry, because in a hurry, can make you forget many of your protective and proactive measures what you are taking. CPR intubation should be done as with all protective gears. No mouth-to-mouth respiration. Nebulization should be done using separate masks. Ask the patient to buy. While doing any painful procedures like suturing, POP application, etc., ask the patient to look on the other side, or if possible, have a screen in between you and the patient, so that there's a possibility that they can scream or shout. That is a place where they can generate aerosol. Sometimes their mask gets dislodged. All those things can be avoided. And changing of sheets and all can be should be done. And try to shift the patient out or to the ICU or to the operation theater or to the ward, wherever the patient needs to go, as quickly as possible. Disinfect that area and disinfect yourself briefly. I'm going to talk about minimally about all the consultation rooms and scan rooms and whatever we have. So we can use a screen between the patient's face and the part we are screening here. Routine use of probe cover can be used, definitely. Invasive procedure should be done as we take precautions in the operation theater, covering all of the patient's body. Only the part which they are going to do the procedure is to be exposed. Disposable sheets should be used. Study should be done as soon as possible. Cleaning of the machines as recommended. In the ICU, where it's a high-risk place, where the patients, many of them are on ventilators or nebulizers. Many patients are in chest physiotherapy. These are all aerosol-generating places. So protective gear should be given and worn at all times. And intubation suctioning has to be done with all protective gear. Tracheostomy, everything should be done with utmost care. No entry of the attenders or limit entry of the attenders if they want. A camera can be placed with each bed kept in a separate chamber so that they can be shown outside. Outside the ICU, an ante room can be set up. And there you can see the patients on the screen. So chest physio should be done very cautiously. Cleaning is to be done very, very regularly and meticulously. And in the ward, probably no special mention required, but we should avoid admissions as far as possible. Discharge all the patients as soon as possible. Staff with protective gear. Sheets to be changed daily or even more frequently. Explain and take special consent for COVID. In addition to your routine consent, for this special consent, like they on entering itself, they are signing a declaration form. We can take a consent form for this one. And masks should be worn by both patient and the attenders at all times, even inside their rooms. Fumigation disinfection after each patient getting discharged, very important. And cleaning of surfaces, as mentioned. Physiotherapy, only one patient at a time, preferably in a well-ventilated surroundings. Mask for the physiotherapist, clean all the equipments, clean all the beds which they are using. And procedure rooms like minor OT, any endoscopy room, take all precautions just as you do in the operation theater. If we are avoid endoscopies and bronchoscopies as much as possible, if at all is required, consider that you are going to do a surgery, preferably in a chamber, it would be better so that the spread of the aerosol can be reduced. And inside the theater, before going inside the changes, what all we should consider in the back of our mind. Elective surgeries, avoid as much as possible. Don't plan for any electives. Emergencies, depending on the emergency, we can wait, ask the patient. Every patient should be screened for COVID. Okay. And if the patient, he can wait, we can postpone the surgery a little bit till the COVID report arrives. Or if it is an emergency, take full precautions and take COVID, still proceed with the emergency. All OT personnel should be given PPEs or any exhaust suits as required. Education regarding donning and doffing, as I have mentioned, is very important. This line is of most important here. Consider every patient to be COVID positive, even proved otherwise. Never take chances. Never ever take chances. Protect your eyes, nose and mouth. So what are the changes need to do is negative pressure OT will be very useful, but in India, I don't think anywhere we are having negative pressure OTs, but at least we can stop the usage of laminar flow, though it is controversial, but still laminar flow creates a positive pressure. So in some areas, it is reported that is causing infections to the OT personnel, the surgeon team, everybody. Cleaning of OT equipments with 1% sodium hypochlorite solution, and wherever possible, central suction can be done. If it is not available, suction of normal thing is very important here. Regional anesthesia preferred, definitely. Avoid general anesthesia as much as possible. If at all there is no other go, the patient can be given general anesthesia in a intubation box. So we can minimize the spread of the aerosol. And these are the common aerosol liberating procedures such as power drilling, reaming, burr, cautery, pulse lavage, bronchial lavage. All these things has to be avoided as much as possible. Preferably, we can make use of an end surgical team, or if a prolonged surgery is being expected, two teams can be doing the surgery so that the exposure with the patient can be reduced. Likewise, the same it holds good for the other operating room personnel also. Two teams can go, first 1 hour with one team, 1 to 1.5 hours. Second 1.5 hours can be probably the other team. Avoid prolonged surgeries. Try to finish, make a quick job and come out. This thing, to avoid traffic inside the operation theater, the surgeon team should be outside till the patient is intubated. And till the patient is extubated, they can stay outside with the PPE on. If required, they will come inside. So that the number of people getting exposed while intubation and extubation can be reduced. So these are the things, physical changes, what we have seen us to be maintained as much as possible. And these are the registers. Many of us are maintaining many of the registers, but with regard to this pandemic, it is wise to keep all these registers maintained properly so that if for any check, for any inspection, we can have it as a ready reckoner to our officials, to ourselves, in fact. So OPA, IP registers as usual, fever clinic and fever referral registers, probably that is very much required now. Disinfection register for our hospital, how are we, what are the measures taken, who are doing it, when are they doing it, all those things can be recorded. Duty register, so that the duty protocol has been equally distributed and there is no overworking or underworking between your staff members. Register for providing PPE, which is signed by the staff, so that they it is to protect ourselves and to show somebody that we have taken adequate precautions. In spite of that, if something untoward happens, we can safeguard ourselves. And last but not the least, the itemized register for procurement of all these PPEs with their bills. Please safeguard all the bills so that it is a proof that we are taking all the precautions which is expected out of us. So many of us have this question in mind. If at all we see a COVID positive patient, what is going to be our hospital? Now it is being relaxed. A maximum of 5 days closure with proper sanitization. Probably the hospital can reopen. Those people in that shift, whoever is working, can go for home quarantine. The other shift people can work as usual. Minimal paramedical staff, as less as possible, should be shuffled across duties so that each person has been having, so that the work has does not have any hindrance and the work goes on smoothly. If at all, in some case, some people do not prefer to work in our hospital during this pandemic, be wise, takes a resignation letter. This is also one of our members' hospital's resignation letter. It is being reproduced with their permission. So like this, we can get it signed from them. If at all they have any myths and fears, we can talk to them, to their family members, and clarify their doubts. Follow labor rules and consult the concerned authorities before reducing your staff strength. Make use of any government benefits if at all available. And maintenance cost is going to increase with the existing PPEs and other quality measures. But income is going to reduce. Explain the staff members if at all we are not able to give them full salary, and we will try to reimburse them later on properly and issue them a certificate of appreciation so that they will be encouraged to work more and they will be very feeling happy. And we have to keep in mind that no longer duty hours, keep the duty hours as short as possible, because it has been shown that longer duty hours fatigue and they are going to have tiredness. So that itself can produce more chances of getting infected. Keep in mind, no one is going to help you during this pandemic. It is only up to us. So have an individualized plan for yourself with the available finances, okay? And government and IMA can help us, but it is our duty, our own responsibility that we take care of ourselves. Passing off this year without any corona infection and without much financial deficit is the real achievement we are going to have. It is being shown that 97% of doctors are going to experience some kind of negative impact. Some people may have 90% reduced income because profitable elective surgeries have been called off. And low income coupled with extra expenses, as I've told you, can take a toll on our hospital's well-being. Minimal work with good quality, cut short unnecessary expenses, don't invest big in for the next 6 months at least, postpone all payments or extend EMI as much as possible wherever you can, and don't keep any unskilled or unreliable or unwanted staff here so that we can save our expenses. For the past 2-3 months under this lockdown, we have learned to have more and more personal hygiene, more and more family time, but how to cut short our personal expenses, improve food and sleep habits definitely, physical fitness we have given more importance. All these things I have learned, and probably all of us would have. I would be very happy if this can be continued throughout our practice, throughout the future. Now to remember, be very cautious, responsible. Do not practice if you feel there is an unfavorable situation prevailing in any aspect. Take precautions, proper financial planning that can only sustain us, because our future, our family future depends on us. Staff management accordingly as per your own plan. Last, life is more important than our practice here. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I'd be very happy to clarify any doubts.
Excuse me. I'm Dr. Navkarasan. My doubt is, you are dealing with private hospitals, no? Suppose a bad case comes when we lose the patient, what is the procedure?
Sir, before that, Dr. Sandeep, 1 minute. First, yes, let the secretary thank you for your talk.
Yeah.
Already some questions have come on the chat box. We'll go one by one. And then let us take questions from the audience. So some questions will not get left out.
Thank you, President. First of all, I thank Dr. Sandeep, excellent and exhaustive lecture. And the practical point of view, given you have come out with very nicely, and your young dynamic surgeon, I thank you. Now I invite the audience to ask questions. First, I'll go, yep. Then I invite Dr. Yomas, you have any questions?
Dr. Meenat Sundaram has already given his question in the chat box. Let me read it out. He says, what is the advantage of scrubs for an OP practice? Why not wear a simple cotton pant and a comfortable t-shirt, or a pant and cotton shirt? Dr. Sandeep.
Sir, scrubs is mainly maintained by the hospital, sir. Any cotton pant, cotton shirt is as good as good. But only thing is, I want to make a mention that as far as possible, we can avoid using the same clothes to be carried home. That's all, sir. Nothing else. Any dress of your choice and comfort can be done. Let it be removed and changed in the hospital premises itself, so that you go with a relatively clean dress.
Okay. Yes, thank sir. You, sir.
Yes,
thank
sir. You, hello. The Dr. typing Thirunam is not.
Also yes, wanted sir. Some questions. Yeah. Please go ahead.
Go ahead, sir.
We are talking about private institution. Suppose a bad case comes and you lose the patient, how you deal with it?
That depends on what case it is. If it was
COVID.
If it is a COVID case, first we have to notify the government in the first place.
Yes.
we have to notify the government, and probably if we lose the patient, we have to pack the body in a surgical scrub sheet and a plastic sheet, three layers, and then refer it, take the appropriate authorities. What they will do is they will ask us where the body should be sent. So we can transport the body there to that particular crematorium, and then they can do the proceeding. The only thing is, all these things has to be, if at all you have a COVID case in your hospital, take a moment each time, and time to time inform the authorities, take their permission, take their advices, and then only proceed. Because right now I cannot give any general guidelines, because what happened last month is not happening now. And each day, newer guidelines have been coming. So, as on date, what has to be done can be clarified then and there, and then it can be proceeded accordingly.
Yes, sir. As a private practitioner, suppose they call for house visit, and we go there, patient's in very bad shape, and they say it's your fever. How to deal with that situation?
Preferably avoid a house visit, sir. I should say.
Sure, sir. Pressure is, the crowd comes and.
Have a video consultation if at all required.
Okay.
Preferably. Okay. We can make use of this electronic media, make use of WhatsApp calls or Pacto, or any method which you are comfortable with, and then try to avoid.
Okay.
Because it is many a times we can see, we need not even touch the patient. If at all prudently, if you are going on a house visit, it is advisable to go with the proper surgical scrub and the shoe cover also.
Okay.
Shoe cover.
The reason they call is they suspect that, old person, they don't know, not responding.
I can understand.
Come and see, sir. Tell us, sir. And you feel it's a fever 3 days. How to deal with such a situation? Embarrassing, no?
Definitely. Yes, sir. Definitely. We cannot refuse all the time.
You're living in society. Society as a doctor.
We cannot refuse all the time, but we will take, I don't say PPE kit will be required when you go to their house. Ask all the people to come outside.
Okay.
You wear a mask, you wear goggles, you wear the surgical suit.
Okay.
Surgical, just gown.
PPE.
Preferably a disposable, not a PPE. PPE will be very exhausting and very much... Yes, sir. Costly, and you sweat a lot inside the PPE. Probably a surgical gown will be enough, disposable, with a shoe cover. Ask all the attendants to come outside. Examine as little as possible. Come outside. Remove off all of your extra clothing, what you are having. Dispose it there. Or pack it. Ask them to dispose it properly. And then we can certify, sir. I think that should be the thing. There's no clear-cut guidelines. Probably it is out of my own experience, and I'm suggesting this one.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, sir.
In clinic, a case comes, suppose 10 years old boy or 23 years old person. It is a fever 2 days. It's just what he says. Will you die? Simply say, go to GH, have a COVID test, then, or give antibiotics. And there's no yet, he knows this is not toxic, not febrile. How to deal with such case? Every case you say, go. They say, oh, you are sitting here.
I think probably Dr. Arunachalam, I think he has a suggestion regarding this.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. Actually, for the first question, when you lose the patient, always the patient, whenever, even if it is a COVID patient, the reaction from the society is bad. So first inform the local police station yourself. Nothing wrong. Ask them for protection. Then you declare to their relatives first. Second question, to go home. Sir, even for a declaration of death, don't visit homes. You would say them, ask for 108, which is doing a good and yeoman service even in the peaceful time. Now in COVID also, they come and they say, there is no life, I cannot take to the hospital. That is enough. Then you say, if 108 declares, then you come back for certificate. You don't go to any home at all. No crowd is important for you, because you are a doctor and they are a patient. The crowd pressure, all those things for certificates or anything, you don't budge in. You just stand on principle. You just say, we are bonded by medical council, and medical council is very, very sensitive now to these things. Unless otherwise, if I have not treated for 6 months, I cannot issue a death certificate to a patient. That is the strong words you have to use, or else I will lose my practice and I will be imprisoned. You just say this thing. Okay. I have to protect myself. During COVID area time, I have issued 2 certificates. I just asked the patients to go to police station to inform, and then the police informed the health officer. The health officer, instead of he gives the certificate that it is not a containment area, the area is not, the patient's home is not in containment zone, then he has given the orders to the sanitary supervisor. That sanitary supervisor has issued 2 certificates to me for 2 different patients on 2 different days, informing me that the patient's home or street is not in COVID area. That certificate I have kept, and then I have issued a form 4 that patient has died in the hospital due to other reason. As I know the patient, I was treating them. Unless otherwise, you don't budge in. You just say, go to police station. If they say there is not a COVID, then I can issue a certificate. By that means, you will be stubborn to deny the unnecessary certificate issuing acts. The last question, that going for home visit for a sick patient, please don't allow anyone of your staffs even go to the hospital, because nowadays any patient can be brought to your home, what you call home, by going for a by auto or any car, anything. If none is there, you ask them to call 108. In case your patient is positive or with the reports, the report came positive, what to do? So in that case, you ask the patient to download Arogya Setu app. That guides them everything. They are a contact medical officer. They can call and they can be gone. Or else you know few private hospitals and then say the government hospital and to go and get treated. Because COVID, we cannot do anything. So we have to explain ourselves in a nice way so that we have done the best. Either even in normal times, we ask them to go to GH or go to any private hospital, which is tertiary care or anything. So the same words you have to use in a polite way, say that even we are in the same suit. Yesterday, I have told in a TV interview also, the government in Chennai Corporation also should come out with a public announcement that what are all to be done if a patient is positive. That guidelines from the government, I think IMA leaders yesterday I have talked, and they will come out with a proper notice within a week, I think. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And regarding a few points to be added along with the Dr. Sandeep lecture, because for surface cleaning, in addition to the 1% sodium hypochlorite solution, you can use the 5% Lysol. Lysol also can be used for the surface cleaning. And another point to want to quote, nowadays at present statistics, only the 10 to 15% of the healthcare workers got infected. That is very, very important, because of the overall statistics, 10 to 15% of the healthcare frontline warriors, workers like doctors, nurses, and healthcare workers got infected in COVID-19. So you should be very, very careful in dealing with the COVID patient. Then, thank you, Sandeep.
Secretary, sir, I have one question to you.
Yeah.
You said you can use 5% Lysol solution, Dr. Yeah. Sandeep, you also. Sir, when we use scrub in the OP clinic, normally what I do in my clinic is, after I go to the clinic, I change into scrubs and then wear a surgical coverall on top of that, wear a shield and a face mask, see only 4 or 5 patients per evening, and then change over into my clothes. I have a washing machine at the clinic. I first soak the clothes in the scrubs in the hypochlorite solution, then put it in the washing machine, wash it, and then hang out to dry. Unfortunately, this bleach, bleaches the scrubs in patches. And after a few washes, it doesn't appear good. Can the can the 5% Lysol solution be used instead of hypochlorite for washing the scrubs and the surgical coverall? Is it equally effective?
Sir, this is the A. Hypochlorite solution, suppose if you want to use the any disposables and everything, then you dip into the hypochlorite solution, then you discard it, because it is antiviral or maybe antiseptic. That is one thing. Second thing, for your reusable clothes, your scrubs, you can soak it into soap and water, then put it into an autoclave. You can put an autoclave, then you use it, sir. That is, you can sterilize things, sir.
I don't have an autoclave, but I can put it in soap solution and then I can wash it.
Yeah, soap solution 15 minutes.
Ordinary detergent solution.
Ordinary soap solution 15 minutes. You soak it, then you take it out, then you dry it in 5 hours in the hot sun.
Sunry is very important.
Yeah, sun, hot sun, or we can then we used to say the mask to be reused. That in the cloth mask, you can boil the mask in the 15 minutes. With the salt water. In salt water, suppose if you boiled salt water, you put the mask or any cloth inside it, then you boil it 15 minutes, then it will sterilize your cloth mask. That is also you want.
What Sarah has mentioned is cloth mask, sir. But for the now N95 mask which we use, recommendations is being followed. One day, that is 6 hours of usage, we can air dry the same N95 mask for about 3 days. It's not sun dry. If we sun dry the mask, we are going to lose the filters. We can repeat the usage of the mask for about 4 times.
I don't use the N95. I use only a 3-ply mask with the face shield. And I have a see-through curtain in front of my table, after which the patient sits. So I have three layers.
That should be enough, sir. I think so.
You have a three-tier system, sir. You need not worry, sir.
Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, we'll go ahead. So thank you, Sandeep. And you have delivered a very good lecture.
I think there are a few more questions here. The IR thermometer definitely is not 100% reliable. But at least that is what we can do, sir. We don't have any other methods right now at the moment to determine the temperatures. So it is now prudent to use only infrared thermometers. And now with this commercial and mass production, I'm doubtful even further whether on this reliability of all these infrared thermometers. But there is no other goal we don't have at the moment. And that's all, sir.
Sir, can I ask a question, Dr. Selvam, sir?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You go ahead, sir.
Sir, regarding that hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis for staff, you said 7 weeks. Now, I think the latest ICMR guidelines say you can continue after 7 weeks also. So
there is no proven, it is not proved to be 100% effective yet, sir.
No. I'm not saying it's 100% proof. That period, I'm talking about the period. After earlier they said it is 1+7, first dose followed by 7 doses. Now they are saying you can continue for a long time, but I do not know how long you can continue. They have not mentioned.
There's no clear cut recommendations but in this.
I think you need to continue, otherwise it is very difficult to work. Now that the cases are increasing, that is one point. Number two, another thing is one suggestion I wanted to give you is in the OP, when you are asking the patient to lie down and then you examine, and the next patient comes and lies down on the same pillow. It is very difficult that too. And if you ask the patient to lie prone, his face will be on the pillow. So what I do is I have a big roll of people put on the dining table in marriage halls, you know, that sheet.
Yes.
Preferably wax coated sheet. I just keep that. Every time a patient lies down, we put one layer. The moment the patient gets up, we throw it off and put another layer. So the patient's, there is no cross infection if at all some asymptomatic carrier comes. One more thing is, you suggested about 3 days or 5 days closure, but recently I verified from the IMA and I also went through the latest GO of the government. I think there is no need to close any hospital, even if you get a COVID patient or even if a staff gets infected. There are some protocols issued recently, and without closing the hospital, you can follow that and continue to run the hospital. Last point I wanted to add is we should not forget that we have most of us have ESI coverage for our staff. So any staff getting into problems, you can refer them to the ESI hospital. The ESI hospital in KK Nagar is now well equipped to handle COVID cases, and they take, because they have the ESI benefits for the leave, for the treatment, everything they have. I mean, don't forget to make use of that in case your ESI covered staff falls sick. Just I wanted to add on this thing.
Yes, sir. Sir, with regard to your suggestion, sir, the third point regarding the closure of the hospital, there is no mandatory recommendation to close the hospitals. But what they say is, it is better to close a hospital, shut down for at least 3 days so that deep cleaning of the hospital can be done. Without, because the routine OP cannot function properly at the site by site, we cannot.